Hello once again. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 155. A tuner on steroids and a grounding system on automatic. And you may have guessed we're going to go back to the Dayton Hamvention. We're going to look at Kessler Engineering. This is Don Kessler, KI6SZ. And he is showing a product that is not on the market yet, but will be hopefully soon, by end of summer or early fall. It is just a super automatic antenna tuner. You're not going to believe what he's got in that thing. And this isn't the guy. This is the product. It's a remote grounding system for your antenna. Mounts out on the tower. It's from RemoteShack. And here's the guy. John Troy, KI4YUM. We met John before back in Orlando, the very first round of Ham Radio Now. And it turns out they are somewhat complementary products. So that should be interesting. And we'll get to that in just a moment. I need to check out a couple things first. In this episode, the previous episode of Ham Radio Now, I made a grievous error. Some emails from contributors. Lee, KB4FYE from Arlington, Texas. Yeah, I did it again. Lee is KB5FYE, not KB4FYE. And then I even screwed up even more. I was referring to this guy. One of the folks that sent me a link to the newsletter was talking about the Village Telco. And I was trying to remember David Rowe's name, and I couldn't remember his name, but I thought I remembered his call sign, and I said VK6APH. And I was really proud of myself for getting the six right. Unfortunately, that's not David's call. David is VK5DGR. And he's the fellow that did the Village Telco and also is behind Kodak 2. The person I was thinking of for VK6APH is this guy, Phil Harmon. And he is in, I think, the very first year. Is that the very first year? Yeah, 2008. First year we did Tapper, a digital communications conference back in Chicago. And he wrote the software for the Mercury software-defined receiver. And he's done a lot of other stuff in terms of software-defined equipment. But back in 2008, this was the thing. It's what Flex has ended up doing, a direct digital conversion, doing the A to D conversion very close to the antenna socket, you know, maybe just after a filter. So that was Phil. So I really screwed both of those guys up. So I wanted to get that cleared up. Also, we have a news bulletin. Bill Pasternak and I were talking about these rules from the FCC that are, at the time we were talking about it in a couple of episodes ago, the report and order had been released, but the effective date had not been announced until it got published in the Federal Register, and the effective date has been announced. It's going to be on July 21st. And it got into the Federal Register on the 20th. Today is the 23rd, so that's a few days ago. So that's the VE stuff and the call sign license credit for old expired licenses, that deal. So coming up on July 21st, things will change. I probably ought to talk to a VEC and see how it's going to make changes to them. All right, let's get back on down to Dayton. First, we are going to check with Kessler Engineering and this antenna tuner on steroids. An awesome device.
Tell me who you are.
I'm Don Kessler. I'm the owner and chief engineer at Kessler Engineering here in Beaver Creek, Ohio.
Oh, so you're local?
I am local, about 15 miles from Hera.
All right. I hope it's not an insult to say I'm looking around at booths where we're looking at stuff that not that many people have heard of, because you probably have a fan base, but I'm guessing you're not ICOM or Yaesu.
No, that's correct, but I'm honored by the inquiry, though. I developed, and I'm probably well known for the AT Auto. I developed the AT Auto, and it used to be sold by another company, but that was my design. And so I still support that product, even though it's out of production. But I wanted to develop a tuner that was sort of a no-compromise approach, so it's a paradigm shift. starting with a fresh slate of paper, a tuner as I would design it. And so I tried to develop a remote tuner where the tuning network would actually be located where the loads are. So to get the tuning network out of the shack, to diminish the size of the tuner presence in the shack, but a fully automated tuner with the capabilities of the AT Auto and more. And so what you see here now is the AT Auto 2, which I'm calling it. It's a fully automatic, it's an RF sensing antenna tuner, but it also takes advantage of the radio I/O capabilities of most modern tuners. It has a Collins patented dual inductor design, and I'm using two vacuum variable capacitors that are 15 to 750 picofarad at 10 kilovolts each. There's three stepper motors, one on each of the capacitors and on the inductor. Each stepper motor has its own dedicated microprocessor controller. Limit sensing is done with non-contact passive optical sensors, so there's no parts to ever wear out. It has its own built-in 29 amp power supply. The tuning apparatus itself requires far less than that, but with this I'm able now to embed, for example, an HF radio, maybe an ICOM 706 Mark II G, I can embed it into this, or I could actually, there's a companion.
You say put the radio right inside?
You could. There's actually a companion skirt that goes with it, and you can mount additional hardware as well, but all the radio I.O. is also built into the box. So there's RS-232, CIV, RS-422, USB, TTL,
et cetera. So it's far more than an antenna tuner.
Well, it's an antenna tuner on steroids, and it has additional I.O. capability. If there's something I forgot, there's an expansion bus, so I can add additional cards to it. It's got eight coaxial outputs. Right now I'm showing this with the SO239s, but these can be N connectors, they can be 716s connectors, etc. You feed it AC power, it has a universal power supply, so you can take it anywhere in the world, and you feed it a fiber optic cable. The fiber optic cable then communicates with the control head, which remains in the shack.
Go ahead and show it to me here with this camera.
So this is the control head, okay? And this remains in the shack, but it's auto-ranging, but it'll do, you know, if you're a QRP-er, you can select a times 0.1 range. So now the meter goes from 0 to 15 watts as opposed to 150. Normal range would be 0 to 150. You hit times 10, it's 0 to 1500. Hit times 20, it's 0 to 3000. If both of these are illuminated, it's 0 to 4500. And it's a very simple display. I don't show you a Smith chart or anything. It's a fully autonomous, fully automatic antenna system. So you kind of set it and forget it. But if you want to look internally, I can describe some of the systems a little bit better. This was a technique that Collins had patented, and what I do is I wind wire off of my inductor onto a shorting spool. This spool itself is grounded, it's made of aluminum.
Okay, so there's a little, I can see it.
Right, it's a phosphor bronze. Yeah, it's a phosphor bronze contact that goes directly to ground. And so what I do, when I want to reduce inductance, the stepper motor will actually move the apparatus in this direction to remove windings from the ceramic drum onto the aluminum drum. If I need additional inductance, we just reverse the process. And then the each of the capacitors here, as I said, it's 15 to 750 picofarad at 10 kilovolt. The bypass and through switching is done here on this board, which mounts to this assembly. And this is the main controller. This is the RF coupler, which has, you know, it's an 8307 based system. The internal network in the tuner is an I2C system. There are five microprocessors here in the box, and there's a another microprocessor in this box. These are all PIC microprocessors, so altogether six microprocessors. What you're seeing here, this is the completed hardware. The cable harnesses aren't in, but this is just to get something to the show. But there are cable harnesses that still need to be populated. The last thing left is to put this thing, actually to finish all the firmware for the microprocessors. A lot of it's done, but it's not ready yet to be sold. I'm anticipating that the production units will be available in late summer or early fall. And the intended location for the tuner itself is actually outside where the loads are. Here you can see an identical unit that's mounted to a piece of tower. The mounting brackets themselves are designed to accommodate Rhone 55, Rhone 45, or Rhone 25 tower, but you can mount this and locate it wherever you want. You're not limited essentially where you can locate it, because the power supply, it's a universal voltage. You just, if you look at it, it's a very common It looks like a computer power input, which you know, essentially it is. So there's an EMI filter that then feeds the power supply, and then there's some additional DC filtering on this board. And I also give you the capability to power, let's say, an HF rig or something off of this. So I tried to think of everything, but if there's something I forgot, again, I could add a daughter board to it and populate it.
So. Okay, so the outside unit's clearly weatherproof.
Yes, and it's meant to be rained on, snowed on, et cetera. It just cannot be submerged. It is not a hermetically sealed box. The box is meant to be open to the environment. And so if you look here, I have two fans. One of them brings air into the box. The other one pulls air out of the box. There's a humidity and temperature sensor on the main controller. So that will monitor the temperature and humidity of the box at all times. And as it needs to, it'll circulate air into and out of the box.
Sealing something like this is an exercise in futility, right?
Well, and sealing a box like this is a bad idea. If you look at most of the boxes that are used in electronics that are outdoors, all of those boxes are perforated. They're open to the environment. So the idea is to keep the box from sweating. The key to that is to keep air moving through the box. I learned the hard way, actually, with a similar enclosure years ago. I tried to make it hermetically sealed. It worked great for about a week, but then everything was non-functional after about a week. You opened it up, and it was just like a sauna bath in there. The atmosphere will normally make its way into a box, and then once it cools and condenses, then you have to have a way for that moisture to run off. So in this case, I'm trying to prevent that. I just keep the air moving as needed.
All right. What range will it tune? Dead short to open circuit?
No, it absolutely will not tune a dead short. A tuner that tunes a dead short is a bad idea. That's a very logical.
I'm kind of kidding.
Yeah, I understand. Conservatively, based on the modeling and the design, it should tune down to about a 5-ohm load, below 1 megahertz, at about a 5-kilowatt rating. So it'll easily cover the 160-meter band. It should also cover 6 meters, based on the modeling and the design. But I can't definitively say that it'll do 6 meters until after I've actually put RF through the tuner. So the real key to doing 6 meters, and now let's just look back in the box here, is keeping the lead length short. So the minimum inductance is really the killer when you're trying to do 6 meters. So I have a fairly hefty strap from the capacitor assembly to the inductor, and then the shunt from the inductor to ground is, again, tried to make it a very low inductance lead. So again, I can't tell you definitively that it'll do 6 meters until I test it, but all the modeling and design indicates that it should.
So it does look like it's designed for really wide range.
It is.
But on the other hand, if someone's putting it on antennas that are up on towers, they're going to be generally fairly resonant antennas and maybe just a little trimming. You know, this is like way overkill?
It could be overkill, but there are going to be times when you want to match some oddball load. The question that you get asked quite a lot is, you know, what's the impedance matching range of a particular tuner? And if it's a narrow range, then you kind of limit the application, and also you sort of limit the market. If you have a tuner that matches a very broad range very well, as this tuner will, then you open up the market quite a bit. But your point is right on. And in fact, like the AT Auto and even this particular tuner, because it is fully automatic and you can set up the personality to work with your particular antenna. So if you had an antenna that was resonant on its own or had its own matching capability, such as a step IR antenna, which is a very nice antenna, by the way, you can now have that antenna fed through one of these coaxial outputs. But the tuner knows that this is an antenna that doesn't require a matching network. So in that case, the tuner would automatically just bypass the RF that you feed it right directly to that tuner, and then you could take advantage of that particular antenna's inherent tuning capabilities. Other antennas, let's say you had a ZEP or a doublet or something that you needed, you know, broadband matching capability, this tuner would certainly do that.
Yeah, now you don't want to feed a non-resonant antenna with coax, but if you've got something coming down with twin lead, which will show no loss, then you could match that antenna anyplace.
You could do. In order to do that, what you would do is then place an appropriate ballon on one of the 8 outputs of the tuner, and then you would feed that balanced output from the ballon to your balanced fed antenna. There will be a similar tuner, which is a balanced tuner, or strictly symmetrical tuner, in a similar enclosure. I'm intending to bring that out next year. In that case, it's going to use two of these same inductor assemblies. The capacitors will be separated, but that's still on the design phase right now. But the box is going to be extended a little bit, but that would be a strictly symmetrical tuner. This is strictly a unbalanced tuner at this point. But there is a companion skirt, if you will, that mounts to the bottom side of this tuner, and you can then add additional hardware. If you want to add a ballon, add let's say you wanted to add an HF rig or something, you could add whatever additional hardware you want. And the mounting fasteners are already included on this enclosure, so that was something we already anticipated. But I designed this to, you know, change the paradigm, get the tuner out of the shack, get it out where the loads need to be, but to also give you a tremendous capability, not only for matching and power range, but tremendous flexibility as far as radios, antennas, and growth for the future. So I didn't want to lock myself into a design that would be obsolete within, you know, a couple of years.
Everybody is waiting for me to ask, how much do you think you want to ask for this?
Well, the market price right now, we're thinking tentatively about $3,150.
So this is serious?
It's serious, but I think it's a competitive price based on the capability and based on the potential competition.
Yeah, and it does a lot.
It does.
Something sitting out there like that is going to be not a magnet for lightning, but the lightning could cause a problem. What do you have in mind for protecting this?
Well, one of the advantages of using the fiber optic feed is that it's impervious to EMI, lightning strikes, etc. So the actual control connection between the tuner and the matching network itself is itself impervious to lightning. So once you make those particular connections, you never have to break those. Lightning protection, you would still need, you know, an appropriate lightning mitigation technique. There are manufacturers that certainly do that, and I don't want to steal their thunder, but, you know, Polyphaser, for example, they make excellent products. So your station will still have to be designed appropriately to handle the lightning strikes. So
I'm guessing you would say if somebody is sticking this box out there, don't just stick it to the antenna.
That's correct. Yeah, you'd want to do, you know, due diligence and use the appropriate mitigation techniques for lightning strikes. And certainly there are manufacturers out there that do that very well. And I'm not trying to steal their thunder at all. I mean,
this box is not your lightning protection. This box is your antenna matching.
That's right. This is strictly an antenna tuner, and so, you know, a prudent amateur would do the due diligence, would procure the appropriate means to protect this against lightning.
Yep. I was just kind of guessing you had some experience in that field too.
Yes, I have a tower in my backyard, and it's hard to maintain. I have a Comet and Diamond antennas that don't last more than a season because they actually get shortened every year by the lightning. So it's lightning strikes occur at my house as well.
Get hit a lot. Okay, where's a good place to find you?
Well, I have an internet presence. The information on this tuner will be available on my website. I haven't really tended to the website so much. I've been trying to stick to the details of designing this new product. But my website is KesslerEngineeringLLC.com. So it's my last name, EngineeringLLC.com.
So it's summer 2014 is right. Your estimate for delivery.
Late summer, early fall 2014.
All right. Well, excellent product. Good luck.
Oh, well, thank you very much. And thanks for asking the questions, and thanks for stopping by.
Yeah. So you're going to have to be serious about this if you want one of those. You've got the big tower, the big antennas, you know, the huge stepper antenna, one of those expensive ICOM or Yaesu or Kenwood radios, or maybe even the Flex 6700. You got thousands and thousands already. This is... And for you, a drop in the bucket. For me, more than my whole ham shack put together. Okay, next. One of the things that I talked to Don about was grounding your station. And you don't want to have a device like this, a remote antenna tuner, that you don't have to go outside to do anything except disconnect the antenna when lightning is on the way. You need something to do that remotely. And so, just in time for that, here's a new product from RemoteShack.
In limited camera mode, talking to John Croy from, what's the company?
It's On The Go Devices. We're out of Plantation, Florida.
Yep. And you're the folks that do the RemoteShack, and we talked to you down in Orlando a while ago. You're saying that people said, oh, the RemoteShack is cool, but I got a problem.
Right, and the problem is that a lot of remote-based users, however they're remote, control their systems, whether it's be the internet or however other methods that are out there, they still have a major problem, which is their antenna is always connected. And so one of the things that we tried to do is solve our customers' problems, and we've solved that problem by an actuated antenna disconnect, which always stays disconnected when you're not using your radio, and then when you're using your radio, it automatically connects.
And demonstrate that. You've got a little remote control thing.
I've got a remote control here, but what I also use, we have another unit that actually plugs into your radio, and it senses your 12-volt that your radio is on, and then once it does, it will automatically send the signal out to activate the antenna actuator called the interceptor, and that is the interceptor right there.
And can you make it play?
Absolutely. So right now, the interceptor is in the up position, which means it is connected to the antenna directly, and the antenna is grounded. So the antenna comes from the top, and then the feed line comes in, and then when you press your power button on your radio, immediately the system starts to actuate, and you will see your antenna or rotor connections will also come in play here and connect with your rotor connections down here at your shack, and the antenna connection will also connect there. There you go, right there.
So looks like it's designed for a single antenna?
That's correct, single antenna systems with a rotor. So what you do is, we also have another version out that has two antennas. So instead of the rotor, if you have a two antenna version, or if you needed two antennas, it'll do that as well. When you are not at home or not at your remote site, or some people, they don't have remote systems at all, but they just want to not have to physically go up during a storm and disconnect your antenna, the remote control comes in handy with that, because it's unsafe, obviously, to go and try to disconnect your antenna during a storm. That's where the remote control comes in handy. However, if you have it hooked up to your radio, our transmitter will transmit out to the unit. It's wirelessly controlled, and the transmitter will go out and make a transmission to the interceptor, and it will always stay disengaged anyway. So while you're walking around your house, and in normal instances, it will be disengaged, so you never have to worry about it. But if you're using your radio, as soon as you go to use it, then it will engage and connect. So if you're in an electrical storm and you're using your radio, all you have to do is turn your radio off, and the antenna will disengage for you and you walk away.
And if you're using the RemoteShack product, you don't have to do anything special, it sounds like. As soon as you turn on the radio remotely, the antenna connects automatically.
That's right. The RemoteShack is all made for that, but of course you can use it with other devices as well. There's just a trigger that's either on or off. So most systems it'll work with. Any type of remote control systems it'll work with.
So it doesn't require the RemoteShack specifically, anybody's will work.
That's right, and because it connects to the radio, it doesn't really matter even if it's the RemoteShack, because as soon as the radio turns on, it doesn't matter who turned on the radio, it's gonna engage.
Yeah, I need to talk to you about synergistic marketing.
Yeah.
Actually, you're probably doing better being able to work with everybody's product, because now this is a good standalone product.
Thing. Right, exactly.
Okay, so, what's our price?
Well, the price is expected to come out. It is a new product. It's expected to come out between $600 and $700. It is solar powered. Because it needs to be totally autonomous. Okay, there are no connections back to the shack. There are no power connections back to the shack. There are no control connections that come back to the shack. So it is sitting here as you see it, as you videoed it. There is nothing connection. There's a battery inside. Okay, there are no wires that go anywhere. So it's self controlled, as far as its automation is concerned.
Okay. When it disconnects the antenna, does it ground it?
Yes, it does. There's a big ground strap or tap at the top of the unit where you connect your ground.
Where do you recommend putting this, at the base of the tower or up at the top?
Yeah, the base at the tower is where it would go, so away from your home, away from the shack, and heavily grounded at the base of the tower.
When will this be available?
Probably, I would say, the end of June.
And how do you guys sell stuff? Is it just strictly off your website?
Yes, you can go to our website, remoteshack.com, and you can see all about it there.
All right, excellent. Thank you, John.
All righty. Thank you.
Very complimentary stuff. You got the antenna tuner, you got the automatic antenna disconnect and grounding system. So you're all set. What more could you want? That's it for this edition of Ham Radio Now. Stop by the website, HamRadioNow.tv, see Arvin, If you enjoyed the program, you can make a contribution and keep things going. Looking forward to the big field day weekend and the secret project that Jeff and I have going coming up this weekend. It's going to be fun, but we will be mobile. We'll be on the road. So look for KN4AQ operating 1 Charlie up and down. I live in North Carolina. You know, this is sort of the East Coast. I'm not driving to California for the weekend, so you can probably guess that whatever we're doing, it's going to be somewhere east of the Mississippi. Yeah, I can reveal that much. So tune us in, Operating 1 Charlie. Jeff will be driving. I'll be operating and logging, having a good time. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Over and out.